from Cincinnati's WLWT, leading the way. This is WLWT News 5 at 6.
There's a gentleman walking around with a gun in the store.
This is the rifle that Mr. Crawford was carrying that day.
For weeks, there have been questions and few answers in the deadly officer-involved shooting of a local man. Repeated calls for the release of the surveillance video from inside the Walmart.
There is a lot of anger right now.
And skepticism about why police fired the deadly shot.
What happened to John is not a special case. It happens everywhere.
The cops are always right, you know, because they're not.
You know, it could have been me.
But tonight, a grand jury has found the shooting was justified.
The grand jury deliberated and they returned no indictment.
Good evening, I'm Cherie Palello. Mike Dardis has the evening off. We have extensive coverage of the grand jury investigation and the difficult questions it now raises about the death of John Crawford of Fairfield. A key piece of evidence is this surveillance video right here. Tonight we're going to show you the uncut portion of the video from the call to police to the deadly shooting. This is the story surveillance video here with the 911 call added and then time synced by the FBI. A warning here, this video is very graphic, but we believe that it is important for you to see it and hear for yourself how the deadly scene unfolded on August 5th in Beaver Creek, Ohio.
Beaver Creek 911, where's your emergency?
I'm at the Beaver Creek Walmart. There's a gentleman walking around with a gun in the store.
Is he got it pulled out?
Yeah, he's like pointing at people.
What does he look like?
He's a black male, probably about 6 foot tall.
Okay, what's he wearing?
Blue shirt, blue pants.
Where is he at now?
He's over in the pets.
Can I have your name, please?
My name is Ronald Ritchie.
Ronald?
Yes, he's like loading it right now.
All right, Mr. Ritchie, hold on 1 second, okay?
Not a problem.
I'm still on the phone with you. This is Fairborn, but they're probably sending somebody.
Okay.
So I'm just going to stay on the phone with you.
Okay. 911.
What's he doing now?
He looks like he's just trying to load it.
He's just trying to load it?
Yeah.
Confirmed. Okay. Is he still in the pets area?
Yeah.
Okay. What's he loading it with, do you see?
I have no idea. I'm not getting that close
to him. Okay, that's fine. Has he got people that he's pointing it around now?
I can't tell if there's anybody he's pointing it at right now, but it looks like he's, like, aiming at things.
Okay. I'm just going to keep you on the phone until they get back on there, okay?
You're fine.
We have to... Oh, he did.
Okay, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Where is he at now?
Here. He's still in the pet section. Just looks like, I don't know what he's trying to do. He's just like pointing at
46, I'll still be interrupting.
2023.
This is Fairborn. I'm still on offline. Do you guys need any help?
Affirmative 90. He's in the pet section.
Beaver Creek?
Yes.
It's Fairborn. Do you guys need any help that way?
Not yet.
Okay.
Thank you.
Staying on the line. I let my sergeant know just in case.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Uh-huh. Okay, sir, tell me what's going on now.
I don't know what he's just like looking around, waving it back and forth.
Okay.
Sir, what type of gun is it? Is it a shotgun or is it a handgun?
It looks like a rifle.
What color is it?
Black.
The black rifle?
Yeah.
All right, you said you saw him load it?
He looked like he was trying to load it. I don't know.
Affirmative. I have a gentleman. He's watching him. Says he's waving it around. Believes it's a rifle. Believes he just put some bullets inside. I have an officer there.
You have an officer here?
I also have another officer on scene.
He's in the back corner of pets right now.
90.
White male, black male?
They're advising
black.
He's in the black,
black male.
Back corner
yeah.
of pets.
He's a black male. What's he wearing?
Black shirt and blue jeans.
Okay, he's a black male, black shirt and blue jeans.
Yeah.
Does he have a hat or anything on?
No, he's got like an afro.
An afro? Okay. Beaver Creek day.
I got it. Have an after.
Right here, please.
Gotcha. What's your name again, sir?
My name is Ronald Ritchie. He just pointed at, like, two children.
Okay. I do have officers there, so stay on the line with me, okay?
Not a problem.
9637.
2025. Is there anyone else around him that came with him that you can tell?
It's just him.
Just him?
Yeah.
Okay. What's he doing now?
He's just waving it around still.
He's on his phone waving around. Kids.
Right.
Okay. Is there kids around him then?
Not anymore.
Okay.
Is there anyone around him now?
There's a kid watching him. He's about an aisle length away.
Okay.
2026.
Sir, what's going on?
Gunshots in the store.
So the grand jury reviewed that video that you just saw, plus hours of audio and interviews with 18 witnesses before reaching their decision not to indict the two police officers involved. We have team coverage for you tonight. WLWT News 5's Todd Dykes has reaction to the grand jury's decision. But we begin tonight with Karen Johnson, who's been covering this case since it broke. And Karen was the only local reporter there today as this major announcement was released to the public. Karen, bring us up to date.
Well, Sheree, the grand jury consisted of 9 people, and they were given 3 options: murder, reckless homicide, or negligent homicide. But in the end, at least 3 voted not to indict the Beaver Creek police officer who shot and killed a Fairfield man here at the Walmart.
This is a real automatic rifle. This is the rifle that Mr. Crawford was carrying that day.
A BB gun. John Crawford III, seen here in the Walmart surveillance video, picking up that gun from a shelf, holding it in one hand while talking on his cell phone with the other.
Mr. Crawford, still on the phone, carrying that rifle in his left arm.
The Fairfield man walks through the store.
At this point, he's got the gun on his shoulder.
Passes a few shoppers. One of them sees Crawford and calls 911.
I'm at the Beaver Creek Walmart. There's a gentleman walking around with a gun in the store.
Prosecutors say the caller is about 100 feet away from Crawford at the time.
Okay, sir, tell me what's going on now.
I don't know what he's doing. He's just, like, looking around, waving it back and forth.
Okay.
Sir, what type of gun is it? Is it a shotgun or is it a handgun?
It looks like a rifle.
Still on the phone, Crawford is seen swinging the gun. A woman and 2 children then turn down that aisle.
He just pointed at, like, 2 children.
About a minute later, Beaver Creek police arrive. One officer fires his gun.
So he fires 2 shots.
Crawford was hit by both, once in the elbow. The other bullet went into his side.
He didn't commit a crime. He didn't do anything wrong. At the same time, the police officers have to be judged on everything they had. All I can say about this case, it's a tragedy.
And Pete Meyer called what happened a perfect storm of circumstances. For one, the gun was out of the box that it should have been in inside Walmart. Also, he says Crawford was talking on the phone and appeared distracted. And also, Beaver Creek police had just gone through active shooter training 2 weeks prior. Reporting live tonight in Beaver Creek, Karen Johnson, WLWT News 5.
All right, Karen, thank you. John Crawford's family declined on-camera interviews today. They told us they will speak publicly tomorrow morning. But the family attorney released a statement this afternoon saying the family is, quote, extremely disappointed, disgusted, and confused, and that they feel like they've been victimized all over again. So our team coverage continues right now with WLWT News 5's Todd Dykes live in Beaver Creek for us tonight. Todd.
Hi, Sheree. Yeah, you know, based on our time today on the ground here in Beaver Creek, reaction seems largely muted, at least here. That includes at the Walmart store where the deadly shooting took place. One woman we spoke to who lives nearby in Bellbrook, Ohio, calls Beaver Creek a typical suburb with what she considers a fairly diverse population. But we did some digging, and it seems that diversity is in the eye of the beholder. Based on recent census data, Beaver Creek is nearly 90% white, and just 2.5% of its population is African American. Regardless, Beth Purdom hopes that what happened to John Crawford won't tarnish this community's reputation.
I don't want it to come down to it's a race thing. We're not a racial community. Bellbrook's not a racial community, and I don't want it to be that. I don't want people coming in here and causing problems.
We also talked to a man who calls Beaver Creek home. Douglas Grile has followed the case, and he paid close attention to the decision by the grand jury.
Police have to go on what's in their mindset at that time, what information they have, and pretty much, it's an unfortunate situation.
And, you know, Douglas Grile seemed to express what a lot of people in this community, the community of Beaver Creek, have expressed and feel about what happened. I called it basically a perfect storm that ended tragically. Reporting live tonight in Beaver Creek, Todd Dykes, WLWT News 5.
Todd, thank you. And the reaction to this decision continues to pour in from all over. Governor John Kasich calling it, quote, a tragedy today. In a statement, he writes, quote, after talking with the attorney general and watching the video myself, I agree with his decision that a review by the U.S. Department of Justice is appropriate. Local State Representative Alicia Reese shared the governor's same opinion today.
Many had said they thought that this young man had done nothing wrong. And it was said today that this young man has done nothing wrong. Unfortunately, John Crawford is dead. And the community and the citizens want answers. And that's why I'm pleased that the Justice Department has agreed to come in.
So count on WLWT to lead the way as the Justice Department begins its investigation now. We're going to be there tomorrow morning as the Crawford family talks for the first time since the grand jury decision just today. And we'll bring you updates about the NAACP's town hall meeting scheduled for a little later this week or possibly even the beginning of next week. In the meantime, go to our website, WLWT.com. You can watch the surveillance video from beginning to end and read the entire emotional statement from the Crawford family today. Plus, you can join in on the conversation about today's decision on our Facebook page, just like WLWT. In other news tonight, a twist in the Tracy Hunter trial. When the prosecution puts her brother on the stand, what he said that may actually hurt his sister's case.
The city needs to get out of the business of being a bank.
The city dishing on Mahogany's debt now that the restaurant has closed. The talk on the table now, Kevin.
And another gorgeous day here in the tri-state. Warmer days are ahead too. I'll let you know about the fall warm-up coming our way. I have a full look at your extended forecast. You're watching Cincinnati's WLWT News 5.
The brother of suspended juvenile judge Tracy Hunter took the stand today to testify in his sister's trial.
I received them. I took them from Judge Hunter.
Judge Hunter gave you his documents?
To look at the file, yes.
And did you give those documents to your lawyer tonight, Trotter?
Yes.
Prosecutors claim Judge Hunter gave Stephen Hunter, her brother, preferential treatment during his time working for the juvenile court. He testified today that his sister gave him documents relating to his firing to give to his attorney the night before his termination hearing. You can catch up on the case every single day inside our website, WLWT.com. Well, a new wave of suspicion is cast now on the janitor accused of killing his coworker. Today, prosecutors in Boone County told the jury the day of the murder, David Dooley left the scene and then came back. But there was something else they say that was even more unusual. WLWT News 5's Brian Hammer continues to lead the way tonight from the Boone County Courthouse.
David Dooley paid close attention as bags and bags of evidence.
This item number 66.
Were detailed by detectives.
182, which is your item 73.
Pictures were shown to jurors from the murder scene inside the Thermo Fisher plant where Michelle Mockby was killed. But among the most powerful evidence presented wasn't in a bag. It was in the behavior of David Dooley the morning of the murder.
The defendant, David Dooley, did he ever tell you that he had left the building that day?
No, he did not.
Did he ever tell you that he had gone home and changed his clothes?
No, he did not.
Would that have been important for you to know when you were visually examining his clothes that day?
Yes, it would have been a red flag for me at that time.
But Dooley's defense team indicated there was a logical reason he didn't say anything about where he was.
At any point did you ask David Dooley about what he was doing that day?
No, I did not.
Were you expecting him to tell you what he was doing that day?
No.
And there's nothing about his demeanor that day that really sets off any alarm bells in your head or anything you can remember as of today?
Nothing that caught my attention.
What's catching the attention of the jury is the question now. In openings, the defense said a canine trained to find blood evidence hit on a vehicle that wasn't Dooley's. But today, a different version of that, an investigator said that canine was tired and the handler told him it wasn't acting right. The jury's yet to hear the cross-examination on that. Brian Hemrick, WLWT News 5.
A jury has now been seated in a capital murder case in Warren County. 19-year-old Austin Myers is facing the death penalty for strangling, stabbing, and then dumping the body of his friend, 18-year-old Justin Back. Opening statements are expected to start tomorrow. The trial is expected to last at least 2 weeks. The Mahogany's controversy continued today. The restaurant's debt to the city of Cincinnati is back on the table yet again, and a council majority says, let's talk now. WLWT News 5's John London boils down what that could mean.
Now, talking doesn't necessarily mean forgiving. The debt is still there, but clearly some citizens who came here to City Hall today believe that forgiving that debt is worth thinking about. Nothing's cooking here now. Mahogany's is in a strange holding pattern, closed, in debt, and without a way to know just what will happen to its tables, chairs, kitchen equipment, and furnishings.
The story has never stopped. For 2 years, it still continues even to this day.
Supporters of restaurant owner Liz Rogers say, look, other city loans have been forgiven. Why not Mahogany's? Most of the city's elected leaders are now saying, let's at least talk. They are directing new city manager Harry Black to meet with Rogers' attorney, even as other citizens warn of slippery slope.
Please do not forgive this loan.
Liz Rogers still owes the lion's share of a $300,000 city loan.
We can't be in the business later of saying, oh, that's okay. So I'm not in favor of forgiving a debt.
As a practical matter, the city could ultimately have to auction the leftovers for whatever could come of it, which is why there is stronger sentiment now for avoiding a Mahogany's-like path.
I think, A, the city needs to get out of the business of being a bank. We're not doing a good job at it.
Charlie Winburn is one of five lawmakers saying further discussion should occur. Just where they'll lead is, like the restaurant biz itself, largely unpredictable.
Ms. Liz Rogers is a partner with us. Until that partnership is resolved, she deserves to have civility.
So as the restaurant sits idle, the controversy does not. The conversation here at City Hall turns a new corner next week. At City Hall, John London, WLWT News 5.
Now, just last week, Mahogany's owner Liz Rogers announced she does not intend to sue the city. Local leaders also announcing a fix today for Hamilton County's morgue's crippled cooler system. The commission approved $3,500 to repair the cooler that quit working over the weekend. The longer-term problem of paying for a new crime lab is still uncertain. Commissioners say there will be a discussion or a decision at the very least by Thanksgiving about possibly moving the coroner's office to Mount Airy. And Hamilton County commissioners unanimously voted today to speed ahead with a Cincinnati to Chicago passenger rail. Leaders approved a proposal now to support the project, but it's still a long way off from happening. They still have to do a feasibility study on funding, they call it. The rail would leave Union Terminal. All right, and so it begins now. UC versus The Ohio State University. Tonight, a Cincinnati professor's Twitter page has now gone viral after he warned students not to wear any Buckeyes gear to his class or face failure, of course. It was all just a joke. More on the big rivalry when we come back. Plus, a look at your forecast.
Now, with the only tri-state forecast that's independently certified most accurate, here's Chief Meteorologist Kevin Robinson.
All right, look at all that blue sky out there, and check out a spectacular evening forecast I have coming your way this evening. 75 at 7 o'clock, by 9 o'clock down to 68, and by the time you join us for News 5 at 11, temperatures will be in the low 60s. So one thing you'll notice, it's not quite as cool out there this evening. Let's count them up. 8 now consecutive days without rain here in the tri-state as our streak of dry weather continues. I'm almost more than certain we will add 9 by going into our Thursday on the dry side. Here's a look outside right now. Plenty of blue sky, just some high cirrus clouds. Hey, go outside, catch the sunset. Should say a beautiful sunset with those cirrus clouds beginning to roll in as you look out towards the west. Right now, 77 here in Cincinnati. It's 79 in Louisville, 77 in London, Kentucky, 75 in Indianapolis. Check those 80s out down there towards Memphis and Paducah. Why is that important for us? Because, well, that's the air that will be coming in our direction for the rest of the week. High pressure going to control our weather. We are sandwiched in between weather systems. Our weather good guy remains in control. Tonight will be cool, maybe not quite as cool as the past couple of nights. So most areas dropping to around 50, of course, outlying areas into the upper 40s. Highs tomorrow, most of us will make it to about 80 degrees with plenty of sunshine. So look at Futurecast. Notice we're sandwiched in a good place here. Not much to talk about other than plenty of blue sky out there and plenty of sunshine. So it's sunny, warm days and clear, cool nights for us to take us through the end of the week and into the weekend. So for tonight, 51 the overnight low. The only concern, maybe a little patchy fog in some river valleys tomorrow morning. Otherwise, beautiful, 80 for that afternoon high. Quick look at your day planner tomorrow, 53 at 8 a.m., climbing up to about 75 by lunchtime. And there's your 7-day forecast. Highs around 80, those nights around 60. George, Cherie, you can't beat this weather with rain not returning till the middle of next week.
Oh, I know. It looks absolutely beautiful out there. And I said I was inspired to wear yellow today because all the sunshine. All right, this was a big announcement today in the NASCAR world.
Yeah, Tony Stewart. NASCAR driver Tony Stewart will not be facing criminal charges. A grand jury cleared Stewart this afternoon. Stewart's been under scrutiny since a sprint car he was driving struck and killed fellow driver Kevin Ward Jr. Ward left his car after a crash with Stewart, and he approached Stewart's moving car. The district attorney in the case says tests found that Ward was under the influence of marijuana at the time of that mishap. UC and Ohio State are closing in on the big game Saturday. Coaches can always find things to worry about, and usually with good reason. Here's part of what worries Urban Meyer.
Thing that I still remember, Tommy Tuberville, Coach Tuberville saying that they're his best group of receivers that he's coached, and that struck a chord with me because I know what he's coached.
That's on Saturday. Sunday, Johnny Cueto will go after win number 20. He picked up 19 last night against the Brewers. If Cueto could make it to 20, he'll be the first Reds pitcher to do it since Danny Jackson won 23 in 1988. Reds and Brewers again tonight. If the Reds win, the Brewers are done. They will be completely knocked out of the wild card and playoff contention.
All right, UC and Ohio State going to be a great weekend for it, too, weather-wise.
Yeah, weather looks spectacular here through at least next week.
All right, we'll see you back here tonight at 11 o'clock. Have a great evening.